So now that we've talked a little bit about how DNA gets between generations of cells in the same person, or mitosis, as well as how DNA gets into new generations of people, through meiosis and the combination of sex cells, let's think a little bit more about heredity, or how traits are passed from generation to generation through DNA. So everyone is a combination of two people's DNA, as you probably know, your mother's DNA and your father's DNA. Chromosomes are these pieces of DNA, and you have one passed from mom and one passed from dad. So this is a karyotype here, which is a way to visualize chromosomes. And so these are the same chromosomes that we saw in mitosis or meiosis, as these X's here, or they can also be out and stringy, like these here. And so here we see them sh in their stringy form. Everyone has, m sorry, the majority of people, and we'll talk a little bit about what it means not to, have 46 chromosomes, and they're split into two pairs. So we most people have 22 sets of somatic chromosomes, that is, chromosomes that are not sex determining, and one set of sex chromosomes. So chromosomes are in karyotypes organized from the largest to the smallest, and that's why you see them in this orientation here. Occasionally, we'll have events like non-disjunction and have a different number of chromosomes than we expect. So, for instance, Down syndrome is caused by a triplicate of 21 chromosome, so also known as trisomy 21. So a genome is all of someone's genetic material. It's all of these chromosomes together. And again, all of these chromosomes are in every single one of our cells. And if we take this together, it makes up a genome, which is the entirety of somebody's genetic material. We think a lot about this in the context of genomics. So, say you're sequencing someone's genome, you are taking note of all of the A's and G's and T's and C's that make up their entire genome. Which is a really massive feat. So normally we think about genetics in slightly smaller sets. So for instance, in the chromosome. So genomes, all of the genetic material in a chromosome is one of these 46 sets. And DNA is the material that these are made out of. So everyone has two sets of chromosomes, one from their mom and one from their dad. From this, we couldn't tell which was from mom or which was from dad. So as we said, we end up here in the end of meiosis with haploid cells, and two haploid cells come together in forming an embryo. And so an ovum from the mom or an egg cell and a sperm from the dad come together, and since they each have only one set of chromosomes, or half the normal set of chromosomes, they're able to combine to have the normal set of chromosomes. So a haploid cell only has 23 chromosomes instead of the 46 that we normally see. And so when they combine, the resulting cells that are the very first cells of the embryo, they have 46 chromosomes. This is the same karyotype we saw earlier. And my question is, from this karyotype, can you tell if this individual is male or female? We can, because we can look down here at the sex chromosomes. So females have two X chromosomes, and males have one X, one Y chromosome. And so the Y chromosome would be here if this karyotype belonged to a male. The Y chromosome is a little bit smaller. And we're going to talk about this next week when we think about genetic diseases. So everyone gets an X chromosome from their mother, and females also get an X chromosome from their father. So this is where the two X's come from, one from mother, one from father. Males get an X chromosome from their mother as well. Then they get an Y chromosome from their father. And so this is how sex determination works in a lot of mammals, and in humans. It's not how sex determination works in other animals. So for instance, birds work on a ZW sex determination schema. And so female birds are ZW and male birds are ZZ. So this is not the only way that sex is determined, but it is the way that it works in humans. So to break this down a little farther, so all of your genetic material is your genome. It's made of material called DNA. A chromosome is one of those 46 pieces that we talk about, and a gene is a portion of DNA, that is located on a chromosome. Not all portions of DNA are coding regions. That is, not all portions of DNA code for a particular protein. Not all of them make functional proteins. It's actually a pretty small percentage, about 1 or 2% of your entire genome actually codes for genes. And genes are things that actually code for protein. And so, for instance, maybe a gene has 99 nucleotides, so that ATGC sequence. And from there, it would code for each of the three nucleotides in sequence would code for a different amino acid, and 33 of those amino acids together form a particular protein. So this gets back to our central dogma from DNA to RNA to protein that we've talked about. So if we're talking from in descending order, a genome is the entirety of the genetic material somebody has. DNA is the general name, any of that kind of genetic material, not specific to any one person. A chromosome is one of those 46 pieces, and a gene is a place on one of those 46 pieces that codes for a protein. So it actually does something. So an allele is a version of a gene. So I was always taught to think about this like ice cream flavors. So both A and B are both ice cream. However, they are different types of ice cream. So for instance, a trait that an allele could code for is whether or not you have detached earlobes. So earlobes could look like this, or earlobes could connected all the way down here. So it could be attached or detached. And we're going to talk about this more next week, but that's a monogenic trait. So it is determined by one gene, and it's really determined by one nucleotide difference. So somewhere, I think on the 11th chromosome, there's an A instead of a G, and you'll get attached versus detached earlobes. So alleles are flavors of genes, they're kinds of genes, and every person has a unique mix of alleles, except for identical twins. But this is how we see our genes coded into traits. So here are some more traits. We have a widow's peak. Instead of having a rounded hairline, we have dimples here on her face, a cleft chin. You could have baldness, you could have detached earlobes, you could have freckles. Rolled tongue versus a flat tongue or a hitchhiker's thumb. And it's not quite as simple as just inheriting one from mom and inheriting one from dad and mixing them all up. There's a little bit more complexity to it, but we're going to talk about that more next week. So every trait has a genotype and a phenotype. So a genotype is the nucleotide bases, or what we think of as the letters that make up a genetic code. And that codes for a particular set of proteins that ends up with our phenotype. So how we see this trait expressed physically in a person. So genotype is the letters, and a phenotype is what we actually see on a person that corresponds to that physical change in the protein. So these are observable traits, and every single trait has both. So to round out, let's ask a couple of questions. How much of your genome do you share with your parents? So it might be obvious, but you share 50% of your genome with your parents. So 50% of your chromosomes come from your mom and 50% come from your dad. What about with your siblings? You are also 50% related to your siblings because they also have a 50-50 chance of getting any of your mom's or dad's chromosomes. So it is random exactly how much that is, but it averages out to 50%. How about your grandparents? So if say we're talking about your maternal grandparents, your mom would get 50% of her genes from each of her parents, And so you would have 25% of your genome that looked exactly like your grandparents. What about with your identical twin? So if you happen to have an identical twin, or maybe it's hypothetical, you would share 100% of your genome with them, because there are the same sperm and egg that are fertilized at the same time. And this means that the DNA combination are exactly the same. So hopefully those are kind of fun questions to start thinking about how this these types of relations are determined by DNA in your genome. So next week we're going to be talking about exactly how heredity works. So we're going to be doing a lot of Punnett squares and thinking about how different diseases are passed from one generation to the next. Looking forward to seeing you then.